such an honor to be here to preach the word of the Lord with you. Again, just really happy to be here. I've enjoyed my time, gotten to know so many of you, and some great people in this church. I'm sure there are many more that I haven't met yet. So the title of the message today is The Energy of a Purpose. And the big idea is simply this: as we purpose to go in the direction the Spirit is going, do we have that? There we go. Well, on the back. Okay. As we purpose to go in the direction the Spirit is going, we find a wonderfully energizing freedom. When we focus on our own ends, we stagnate and are left with a sense, is this all there is? I want to introduce the message by something I discovered a few years ago about our community that you may not know. Maybe you do, I don't know. But I was into family history. My ancestors, the Hawkins, settled when they came to this country. They settled in London in the 1830s. My great-great-grandfather was an officer in the army there during the time of the 1837 rebellion, when all those rebellious folks from Elgin County began an insurrection. Anyway, I was, and I'm not sure of all the historical, and maybe some of you history buffs can tell me more about the details of that, but anyway, I was reading a letter from a soldier in the barracks there in London at the time, and he said he had a vacation, and he and a friend got into a boat in the Thames River, and they sailed all the way down the Thames River until they got to the Great Chatham Swamp. I don't know if you knew that that's where you're living, the Great Chatham Swamp. But that was kind of interesting to me because I grew up in London and only a couple blocks from the Thames River. And, you know, I was an adventurous boy. Myself, my friends, we would played by the Thames all the time. We had a vine. We swung out over the river, much to our parents' consternation and so on. But and I was, you know, really obsessed with the idea of being like Huckleberry Finn, getting a raft and sailing down the Thames River, especially when it was moving fast in the springtime. And I always wondered as I went west where I would end up. And now I know. The Great Chatham Swamp is where I've gone. Well, not really, because we drain swamps. Swamps have, just the word has a very unpleasant connotation. When you're swamped, it's not a good thing. Swamps conjure up images of smelly muck and creepy crawly things and slithering things and stagnation and disease and so on. So we drain swamps. But and on the other hand, Chatham doesn't just have a swamp, it also does have a river, and rivers are completely different. But here's a picture. This is Tecumseh Park. People gather by rivers. People are attracted to rivers. Cities are built up around rivers like Chatham. Whole civilizations like the Nile and the Euphrates, civilizations built up. People are attracted to rivers. Rivers have power. They get things done. They can generate electricity. They can grind wheat. Swamps just kind of spread themselves out and go are useless. So what's the difference? Both water. Difference is that rivers move. Rivers are going in a direction. And so I think we can learn something, a lesson from the swamps and rivers, that go having a purpose, going in a direction, gives us life and energy. It gives a spring in our steps when we know where we're going. We're attractive to people. People like to know, they like people who know where they're going. If we try just to go everywhere, spread ourselves on every whim, every impulse, every purpose that comes along, we end up doing nothing and accomplishing nothing. There's a story of David Hume, who is considered the greatest philosopher ever to write in the English language. And David Hume was a skeptic. He's known for tearing down everything that came before him, an atheist skeptic. And one day he's in the streets of London, and one of his top students he sees racing through the city. He says, "Where are you going?" He said, I'm going to hear George Whitefield preach. And George Whitefield, the great Scottish preacher, very instrumental in the first Great Awakening in the U.S. and all over Britain. And Hume was aghast. He said, why are you going to hear him? You don't believe what he says. And the student said, no, I don't, but he does. And Hume himself would say later that it was worth going 20 miles on horseback to hear George Whitefield. We're attracted to people who know where they're going. And we see in the passage we read that Jesus had a very definite sense of purpose. If you look at scripture, the Gospels through that lens, you'll see that he was extremely focused, a focused individual. He had a purpose, and it's clearly stated here in Luke that the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me. Some of you that know your Bible will know that the anointing in the Old Testament was always for a purpose, for a task to initiate somebody into kingship or into the prophetic ministry or a priest and so on. People were anointed to get something done for a purpose. Jesus said, the Spirit of the Lord is on me because he's anointed me to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim freedom to the prisoners, recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free, and to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. Whole lot about freedom in there. The year of the Lord's favor. Jesus is quoting a passage in Isaiah 61. And the Hebrew there, the year of the Lord's favor, is really a reference to the year of Jubilee. The whole year in the Old Testament where slaves were set free, debts were forgiven, nobody worked. It was like one big party all year long. And so Jesus said, that's my purpose. I've got a clear focus to set people free, to bring good things into their life, and to reach out to those in need, the poor, the blind, the oppressed. That's my purpose. I'm coming in the power of the Spirit. I have so much energy. I have so much healing, so much power available. I'm going to the very least of these to demonstrate what God can do. And so that's what he did, his whole ministry, deliberately looking out for the widows, the ones that were shunted aside, the lepers, the prostitutes, the tax collectors, the lowest of the low. He said, you know, where are the lowest you've got? That's where I want to go, because I'm coming in the power of the Spirit to bring healing and to bring freedom for everybody. And we can't gloss over that coming in the Spirit of the Lord being on me. This is the sixth reference to Jesus being intimately connected to the Spirit in just 1.5 chapters of Luke 3 and the first half of chapter 4. This is a sixth reference, the fact that Jesus is vitally connected to the Spirit. In Acts, summing up his whole ministry, Acts 10:38 says, God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, who went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. And Jesus, of course, is modeling the life that we're supposed to have. I mean, the climax of the gospel, the climax of the atonement for us is the coming of the Holy Spirit. Having our sins forgiven, yes, that's just preparatory to the day of Pentecost and the life of the Spirit. So we read about being born of the Spirit, being guided by the Spirit, being filled by the Spirit, being led by the Spirit, being baptized by the Spirit. The whole New Testament is full of Spirit language. And yet, it's something we don't understand very well. Some people just equate it with our mind, but that's clearly not what the Bible is talking about. What's it mean? What's it mean to be in the Spirit? And I would suggest that the passage we're reading today tells us, it, or at least it gives us, it infers what that means. Going in the Spirit is moving outward to others. Moving inward toward self, focus on self, is putting yourself out of the Spirit. That's not the direction the Spirit is going. Ezekiel gives us this wonderful picture in chapter 47 of his book. It's the temple of God, and out from under the doors of the temple ushers a stream which then turns into a river. And he says, wherever that river goes, it brings life and healing. Of course, it's a picture of the church, the temple of God. The river of God flows out of the temple. It is to flow out to the church. The message of the gospel is, you're okay. You are loved. Everything's fine. Don't worry about yourself. Don't worry about anything you've done. The cross takes care of it. Now your job is to move in the direction of the Spirit. Your job is to get up. It's a higher plane that's really available to us all the time, according to where we look. If we're looking inward and thinking about ourselves and focusing on ourselves and me and mine and my family and my this and my church and my, we take ourselves out of the game. But that outward focus, first to Christ and then out to the hurting and to the needy, that is what it means to be in the Spirit, in my opinion. That's at least, we might say, is to get into the river and go in the direction that the Spirit is going, out to the underdogs. It may be the poor, it may be the mentally ill, it may be the depressed, it may be your spouse when after their parent has died, or it may be they're your friends whose kids are struggling on drugs, it may be to a lonely senior, it could be anyone that's hurting. That's the Spirit is moving outward to the hurting and to the vulnerable, to the marginalized. The thing about having a purpose, about being in this river of the Spirit, is that having a purpose is very limiting. When you're going in one direction, you can't be going in another direction. What's the difference between rivers and swamps? Rivers have banks. They move, they flow in a direction. Swamps spread themselves out in all directions and go nowhere. And this is clearly from Scripture. What I'm preaching to you this morning is clearly your purpose, my purpose. Jesus himself, he models it. He was extremely focused. And he says, the Spirit of the Lord is not on me to go to those who've got it all together. He said the healthy people don't need a doctor. The good shepherd leaves the 99 and goes to the one. I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. You see this over and over again, very, very focused on his mission. At the end of this chapter, he goes to another town, Capernaum, and he does healing. They want him to stay, and he says, no, I'm focused. I've got to go to other towns to preach the gospel. And it's really important that we pick this point up about having a purpose being limiting. Because this purpose, when we see the purpose of God reaching out to the vulnerable, going to those in need, much of the Bible tells us how people fail to get this over and over and over again. Because we have this gravitational pull of self that keeps us locked in, looking at ourselves. And we can't seem to break that pull. You know, we want to go out and love like Jesus and so on, but we're pulled back. Our attention is pulled back to self, me, mine, my family, my things, my stuff, my this, my that. And so we have to be extremely intentional. If you want to walk in the Spirit, if you want to go in the direction of the Spirit, it's not going to happen naturally. You have to be very, very intentional. This very chapter, after Jesus makes a statement about the Spirit of the Lord being upon him for this purpose, he starts talking to the crowd about two individuals in the Old Testament. He said, in the time of Elijah, famine going on for 3.5 years, he said there were a lot of widows in Israel, But God only came through the prophet Elijah to one of them, to one, a widow in Zarephath in Sidon. He said, likewise, in the time of Elisha, there were many lepers in Israel, but only one was healed, and that was Naaman the Syrian. They got so mad when he said this that they tried to kill him. You can read it in the end of Luke 4. They tried to push him over a bank, but he walked through their midst. Why were they so mad when he said that? What's the commonality, the common thing between the widow of Zarephath and Naaman? Anybody? Outsiders. They were outsiders. They were Gentiles. Exactly. And so they got so incensed because Jesus was saying that God cares about, God is moving. He's got a purpose for these outsiders. You need to move out of your four walls and touch the world. The Apostle Paul, really, really interesting little tidbit in Acts 22. You may not have noticed this before. And if you have, you've probably scratched your head like me. But Paul is talking to a large crowd there in Acts 22. He's recalling his testimony of being saved and you know, Damascus Road, receiving his sight. And then he goes to Jerusalem and God meets him again. So he's going on and on talking to the crowd about this. And then he says this. He says, then Paul says, the Lord said to me, go, I will send you far away to the Gentiles. The crowd listened to Paul until he said this. Then they raised their voices and shouted, rid the earth of him. He's not fit to live. They were shouting and throwing off their cloaks and flinging dust into the air. They went totally bananas. Flinging off their coats, that was something they did before they stoned people. It's not fit for him to live. Isn't this incredible? They listened to him. Everything was fine. Everything's cool. Until he said, we're going to go outside of the group. We're going to go outside of me, mine, and us. And then they just got incensed. This is the whole history of human beings, tribalism. You know, my clan, my tribe. And it's something that Jesus came to nail to the cross and teach us to reach out to those beyond us. I'd like to share a story with you that kind of illustrates this. A man whose life was definitely a self-centered swamp. In my work with NeighborLink and Wraparound, I've gone a number of times to Narcotics Anonymous meetings. And then one time, this guy's giving his testimony, and he was talking about just how incredibly selfish. Of course, you know, he was an alcoholic. Most addicts are, they're selfish, right? They're focused on their cravings, and that's all they can focus on. They're captured, they're imprisoned to their cravings. And he was like this, and it had cost him his family. And so finally he gets sober, and then he says, then a year and a half later, he says, I went into rehab. I thought, that's strange. You're already sober. Why are you going into rehab? And he used an expression that they have in those programs that I'd heard of, and I thought, that's really interesting. So he said, I was a dry drunk. I was dry. I wasn't drinking anymore, but I was still a drunk on the inside. Nothing had changed on the inside. I still craved alcohol. I was still selfish. I was still self-centered. I was miserable. I was a miserable dry drunk, and dry drunks make everybody else around them miserable as well. And I thought, you know, I couldn't help but think, you know, that's like a lot of people sitting in church. They don't do the bad things anymore, but, you know, they're not happy. It's a drudgery. They don't do the bad things, but they're maybe still hankering after them. And they're dry. They're a dry drunk. The takeaway of the message today is you don't have to be. There's a plane, a higher plane that God calls us to. And it's so mysterious, it's mystical and so on, but it's just as simple as making a decision to go in the Spirit's direction. It's a decision to crucify self, self-centeredness. It's very simple, but it's incredibly difficult. It's really, really simple. Just looking to Jesus, making a firm decision that I will walk in the path that he's walked. I will walk out with the river flowing out of the church, flowing out of the house of God to hurting people, whether it's somebody in intergenerational poverty or whether it's my cousin and his marriage breakup or wherever it is, I will be led. And that's the exciting thing about it, is that God leads us. You can't solve all the world's problems. You can't solve all Chatham's problems, but you can be led by the Holy Spirit to solve, or be at least be a part of solving somebody's problem. That's the exciting thing, you know. It's really not that exciting to kind of just be a Christian and have a bunch of New Testament laws that I'm following, as though it was just God gives us all, he gave us the Old Testament laws, now he gives us a set of New Testament laws. And you know, I mean, that's, for a lot of people, that's, some people that's okay, but a lot of people that just bores them to tears. And kids don't usually, aren't really attracted too much. But you talk about a life in the Spirit, a mysterious life in the Spirit that we're called to. That's really, really exciting. And, you know, I know there's all kinds of pitfalls people can fall into, but that's why we need teachers and leaders and elders and mature people that can help steer people that have experience in getting into the river. Because that's where the life is. That's where satisfaction is. That's where the joy is and the freedom. And I know that, you know, you have, obviously you must have people here that get this, because you're involved in quite a number of things that are reaching out. We heard about some of them in the prayer, the refugee ministry, and you've got your friendship and coffee break and gems. And I understand you're studying in cadets, you're starting a divorce care program, summer outreach, and so on. You're part of NeighborLink, you know, who I work for. NeighborLink is really just a group of people say, hey, we want to keep this in front of our mind. We want to keep this direction, because we know our bent to self-centeredness. We know our bent to me, mine, and us four and no more. We want to keep this focus outward. So you're doing that. I would just encourage you to, you know, some of you are, probably some of you may not be. Obviously, there's all different kinds of situations in a crowd this size. Encourage you all to come together and to focus and to sharp iron sharpens iron, one friend sharpens another, Proverbs says, to do that for each other, to focus, and making this church life more and more exciting as you learn to get into the Spirit, as to follow the direction of the Spirit out to the hurting, broken people around you. We're going to sing that hymn. I actually never heard it before. Hark the Glad Sound. Your music team want to come up now, and we'll pray first, but come on up. I like the second verse. It says, he comes, the prisoners to release, in Satan's bondage held. The gates of brass before him burst, the iron fetters yield. Let's pray. Lord, the gospel is just so amazing, this freedom that you promise. Freedom from being chained by our desires, by our cravings, by our self-centeredness, breaking that pull, smashing the pull of gravitation, the gravitational pull of self. We thank you that you teach us that it is for freedom that Christ has set us free, but don't use that freedom for an occasion to the flesh, but by love to serve one another. Lord, we dedicate this morning to you as your people to commit ourselves, to affirm that that's the direction we commit to going. We know when we fall down and turn around and look inside and get caught up in our own little concerns, that when we confess that, when we simply just turn to you again, we're forgiven. We can just keep on walking, keeping looking outward to you and to one another. So I pray for this congregation. I pray for, as they look for a pastor, that he will be one or she that will keep them focused on this mission, the life in the Spirit, the purpose of the Spirit, bringing life and healing through Jesus' name. And we thank you. Everybody said, amen.